All right. My name is Dr. Steve Mayner. I'm a fellow at Scaled Agile, the providers of SAFe, the Scaled Agile framework. Today, we're going to continue a journey that I actually began the three summits ago. And it's the topic has to do with the research that I began around what does it take to be successful in driving organizational change, the kind of organizational change that you have all heard at this summit and past summits that is inevitably going to come about as a result of embracing this new mindset culture of DevOps, Lean, Agile. So I'm not going to go into the sort of the main message of what the result of that research was, which was how leaders lead have a very significant direct correlation to whether or not organizational change can be successful. If you're interested in all of the description of transformational leadership and the research that we talked about in those past presentations, feel free to check out last year's plenary talk that I gave. It's on the YouTube channel, or you can look at the State of DevOps survey. Gene and Nicole really kind of got on board with this the last few years, incorporating their research. You'll find it in Nicole's book, Accelerate. So if you're not familiar with it, go check that out, because that's not what we're going to talk about today. Today we're going to do something a little bit different, and it stems from two key assertions that I've made the last couple of years around the research. And it basically boils down to these two things. First of all, what I found in the research was that these behaviors, these competencies of transformational leadership, actually have a greater influence on followers' commitment to supporting organizational change as compared to let's just implement some change model, which I thought that was pretty amazing. And then the second thing that I was really excited about was where the research said these behaviors can actually be learned. We're not born with them. It's not, you know, haves and have-nots. If you believe that if leaders lead in a certain way, that it can help drive successful change, you want to learn how to adopt those behaviors, you absolutely can. Well, earlier this year, as we were kind of talking about, you know, what the focus of this year is going to be, Gene asked me as we were preparing to go off to the leadership forum that he has with a lot of the speakers at the conference every year up in Portland. He said, "Steve, you've been making this assertion that these behaviors can be learned. And that's a real interesting claim. I want you to prove it." Okay. So he said, "Here's what I'd like for you to do. At the forum, when we get all the speakers together, I'm going to give you a 90-minute block, and I want you to teach us transformational leadership." So, of course, Gina doesn't quite work that way. But hey, I'm always up for a good challenge. So I said, "Great, let's give it a try." And so for 90 minutes, I did some interactive exercise kind of things that I've been working on in a course we've been developing, and it was a great experience. Everybody had a great time. It was kind of eye-opening around, hey, I actually can change my mindset and change how I react in certain situations. So, yay, we accomplished the mission. Well, then it comes time to get ready for DevOps London. Gene calls me and says, "Steve, you know that thing you did in Portland with the leaders? Hey, I'd love for you to do that in London." "Oh, but you don't have 90 minutes, you have 30 minutes. So, all right. So now we're going to make people transformational leaders in 30 minutes. Nah. Well, I can't make anyone a transformational leader in 30 minutes, obviously. However, what I do hope that we might be able to do in this session is expose you just a little bit to some of the interactive kind of ways we have been working with leaders in different organizations to develop their capacity, their competency in some specific behaviors that, again, the research shows that if you lead in these ways, followers will react to that in a positive way and embrace change, right? That's what's basically the fundamental premise. So, now, in order to do this, we're going to have to get interactive. I hope the folks that did come today actually read the abstract, because you're about to discover this is going to be a whole lot of you doing stuff and not a whole lot of me talking. So we're to set this up, I need to do a couple of things for me, all right? First of all, I need you to help me as we manage the time boxes, because I'm going to move through some exercises here very quickly. But we only have so much time for each exercise. So I'm going to have a little timer up here. And when the time box is done, I'll let you know. You'll hear the timer go off. And when I raise my hand, you raise your hand and stop talking, and we can move on to the next exercise. Right? That's the first thing. The second thing is, right, we got lots of chairs in here and up there, and everybody is spread out. And if you're off in the hinterlands with no one around you, this is going to be a really tough thing to do. So right off in the first exercise, before we get into the first exercise, I'm going to give you a minute, and you'll actually get to see what the timer looks like here. And what I would encourage you to do, now nobody's going to force you to participate, but I promise you, you will not get as much out of this session if you want to just kind of be off by yourself. So, in 1 minute, find a neighbor and introduce yourself to each other, because you're going to be experiencing this together. Everybody got it? Oh, come on, be brave. You can do this. It's not that hard. All right? We're going to practice some social skills here. 1 minute on the clock. Ready, go. Hopefully everybody can see my timer. All right, we've got about 30 seconds left. I see lots of movement in the back. I hope you're getting together, because with these lights, I can't see you. And see, notice the timer's even flashing, so you know we're coming to the end of our time, right? How about that, huh? Pretty cool. All right. Now, see, that wasn't so bad, was it? You got to meet somebody new, and we're already starting off on a great note. All right, so here's how this is going to work. I showed you the four-quadrant model for transformational leadership. I'm going to give you a very brief little snippet of one part of that dimension, and then you're going to immediately get an opportunity to practice it. All right, so here we go. So the first quadrant, if you recall the first slide, was this idea of vision. So one of the things that the writers of transformational leadership talked about is transformational leaders have this ability to communicate and articulate this compelling vision of a different future in such a way that it is simple, it is understandable, it addresses the why. And if you're a Simon Sinek fan, you know, start with why. We need to know that answer to be motivated around something. So communicating it repeatedly, we have to hear it more than once. Different forums, different channels, different. Some people are visual, some people are oral, some people are tactile. Two-way engagement. It's not just leaders top-down talking about vision, but engaging the organization and collectively building our organizational vision. And then using stories and metaphors and examples, we're a storytelling culture. And so the more we can use that, the better off we're going to be. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to give you a chance to practice that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a minute on the clock for you to just to think about this. What is an element of your organization that you are associated with that you are personally passionate about? Hopefully you can find something. Hopefully it's the mission, it's the product, it's the customer, something that you really love getting up in the morning and getting into work and being a part of. I'll give you a minute to think about What would a 1 minute elevator speech be about what that passion is and why you're so excited about your organization? And how would you communicate in a way that is simple, compelling, and answers the question why? So I'll give you a minute to think about it. And then for the next 2 minutes, you will share that vision with your pairing partner. So one person will have a minute, and then we'll swap. And then the next person will have their minute. And it's just a good way. Am I effective at communicating in a clear and compelling and motivating way? Everybody got it? Pretty easy. All right. So here we go. I'm going to put a minute on the clock. I'll give you a minute to think and prepare. And then we will have you share. So here we go. Off you go to think about what your vision's going to be. Think about how would you communicate it? What would make it clear? What would make it compelling? What would help convey the passion that would make others say, hey, that sounds pretty cool. I think I would like to be a part of that too. Oh, 20 seconds left. I wanted to give you your full time to prepare. You ever felt a minute feel so long? All right, here we go. Almost done with the time box. Pretty, I like that. Okay, here we go. First person. Here is your time box to share your compelling vision. On your mark, get set, go. Five seconds. All right, time's up. Now reverse. The other person, share your one minute elevator speech. On your mark, get set, and go. Ten seconds. All right, and that's time. And now it's time to come back to the front. Here we go. Excellent. Great job. Thank you so much. Very helpful. All right, you guys did a good job with that. It seemed like there was a lot of good conversation and some energy going on around the room. So let's keep it going. So vision was just one quadrant. There's a lot more to that dimension. But again, this is sort of your tapas of leadership, right? You just get a little taste of it, right? Let's go to the next piece. The lower quadrant on the right-hand side is about conceptualizing authenticity. So Burns, who was the originator of transformational leadership, described this as the ability to walk the talk. So an authentic leader is a role model of the desired professional and ethical behaviors. They exhibit things like honesty and integrity and transparency. And that builds trust. People trust leaders when they lead with authenticity. So what are the attributes of an authentic leader? Well, they're self-aware. They know their strengths and they know their weaknesses, and they're not afraid to be honest when they make a mistake. And I think we've all had that opportunity to work for a leader that would be that transparent and say, hey, I'm learning and I'm growing too, and that engenders trust. So talking about their learning journey, recognizing that I don't have all the answers. We're going to build a team, and together we're going to have the answers, and I'm learning just like you are. Their behaviors are consistent with their stated values. If they talk about, hey, it's important that we have a culture that looks like this and behaves like this, and this is how we treat each other, it doesn't work if they themselves are not modeling those behaviors, right? And of course, ultimately, the definition of integrity, doing the right thing when no one else is watching. So let's practice. So what I'd like for you to do is to think of a real life experience, an embarrassing moment, a mistake. It doesn't have to be, you know, something that is you know, deep, dark family secret, but we all have those moments that are not our proudest moments. And normally in the class that I normally teach with this, we use a sketching exercise. You don't have to sketch anything out. If you have paper, that's great. If you don't, you can just describe your picture would look like what? It could be a mountain, it could be a door, it could be whatever. And then explain why that image is reminding you of a particular moment that was a mistake, a failure, something that you're not extremely proud of. So again, I'm going to give you a minute, let you think about what that's going to be, and then you'll have, just like in the last exercise, the ability to share that with your pairing partner. So here we go. 1 minute, and think about what is that embarrassing moment? What is that failure? And how, if you did have paper, if you don't have it, what would be the picture that you would draw that would illustrate that auspicious moment? I didn't know they were going to give me cool music to think by. That's kind of nice. About 10 seconds. I got your picture ready. All right, so here we go. 1 minute on the clock. First person, share your embarrassing moments. On your mark, get set, go. And time. Okay. Switch. Next person, share your embarrassing moment. Ready, go. 10 seconds. And time, all right. Everybody come back. Hello. All right. Now that was not so bad, was it? Nobody spontaneously combusted. It's okay to be a little transparent and be a little human. The third quadrant is about growth. This is an attribute of a leader that really cares about their people. They want to know and they want to be a part of helping their people grow. And I love how David Marquet in his book, Turn the Ship Around, talks about this need to grow people and build in them two key pillars, the pillars of technical competence and organizational clarity. And what I talked about in competence is this ability to grow in people, the ability to take responsibility for making their own decisions, giving them goals, communicating with intent, continuously repeating the message, and creating a safe environment where it's okay to fail. People learn by making mistakes, and they need to have the environment that allows that to happen. Giving them rules for decision making. If we're going to have self-organizing, self-managing teams, they have to know what the guardrails are and what are the boundaries we can make decisions within. And then, of course, encourage and support them as they're learning to do that. But they also have to have the organizational clarity, the context in which the decisions are made. Where is the organization going? Beginning with the end in mind. He talks about focusing on excellence versus just focusing on avoiding errors, right? Exhibiting genuine care and concern, coaching, individual recognition, active listening, all of those great, great tools. And I love this quote from his book. It's not about taking control and attracting followers. It's about giving control and growing leaders. And that really sort of summarizes what this quadrant is about. So in this exercise, it's a little bit different. So you're going to pair, but now we're not going to do a switch. So one person needs to be person one, and you're the subordinate. And you're coming to person two with you're escalating, right? I want a decision. What the person two, the supervisor, understands is that person has the technical competence to make the decision. So for some reason, they're not comfortable making it. Think about how you would encourage them without just saying, hey, you just make the call. That's just like throwing it over the wall. But how would you encourage them to help them see that they actually do have the competence to make that decision? All right? So let's give that a try. I'll give you a minute to think about it and then 2 minutes to do the role play. So on your mark, think about your scenario, what the situation is, and then we'll give you a chance to practice it. Here we go. Ten seconds. All right, 2 minutes on the clock. Role play, ready, go. We're at the halfway mark. Ten seconds. And time. All right, that's it. Let's come back. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. So the last quadrant is about innovation and how do you foster innovation in high-performing teams that can challenge status quo and create differentiating solutions. And this is really where the originator of transformational leadership, Burns, really kind of added to the body of knowledge and said, look, you know, having those other attributes are great. At the end of the day, we still have to perform. We have to differentiate ourselves in the marketplace and we have to produce a profit. Best way to do that? Is create awesome, high-performing, empowered teams, unleash them to go challenge the way we think, the way we build things, encourage that open, you know, hey, why are we doing things this way? And then focus that innovation energy on solving real problems, right? Now, the last exercise here I'm not going to do because we're running a little short on time and I don't want to freak the people out back to the stage. Oh, my God, Steve's going to run over time. Nope, we're not. But what I hope you got from, and this would be a discussion exercise, what I hope you got from this is just a sense of how it is possible through some exercising of some different leadership muscles, some thinking process, some communication processes, how we think about what it means to be a leader and grow other leaders, we can actually transform ourselves, transform our leadership capabilities. Leaders at all levels, not just people that have the titles, but our leadership competencies throughout the organization. I know this because we've actually built last year I talked about the desire or the vision to create a course that would test, could we actually do this? Is it repeatable? Is it scalable? And we built it. And I tested it. I've tested it over the last year. And while this is scrolling, I'll just describe it very quickly. We took in the second largest media and entertainment company in the country, first a senior level group of leaders through this process. Same thing you just experienced a little taste of. Very interactive, very much hands-on, and very much focused on their context. The problems and the challenge they were facing in their organization as they were pushing down this path to DevOps adoption. And then after we did the senior leaders, we then did the next group of leaders at the next level, and it was just a phenomenal experience. It very much encouraged me that yes, we can in fact do this. We can repeat this and take it to all kinds of organizations. So with that, I close with my ask. We are still looking for the opportunity to test this elsewhere. We would love to have safe customers because we need to test some things that have to do with the scaled agile context. But if you think your organization might be interested in becoming a part of this journey, there's my contact information. Give me a ring, let me know, and I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks a lot.